shades. All right. Well, the first question is for you, Tim. Tim, I'm a big fan of your work with Uma Jets, but I never knew you played with two of my favorite other bands, World Party and Finn Brothers. Could you talk about those experiences?
Sure. World Party, I played with a couple of times. Well, I was supposed to play with Carl a couple of times. He suffered a stroke and had to cancel a tour that I was supposed to do in the mid whatever 2005, something like that. And then I ended up doing some shows with him in California on the last sort of big tour that he did in the States with a band, Jeremy Stacy and I, who plays on a record, did that. And we also, Jeremy and I, played with the Finn Brothers. Neil Finn had worked with and had toured with Sheryl Crow, and he came to see us in Los Angeles a couple times and asked me if I was interested in doing some stuff with him at that point. And funnily enough, was telling him at that breakfast meeting in Los Angeles that Roger had been hired to do a remix for him, which he was slightly unaware of at that moment, which made for kind of an odd second of his record company guy was sitting next to him, who he looked at and said, "We did that?" And the guy was like, "Yeah." So anyway, I ended up touring with him later, with he and his brother Tim Finn, as the Finn Brothers, Jeremy and his twin brother Paul. And man, that was a maybe one of the best musical experiences of my life, that tour. Just all those songs and just the way they traveled with their family and stuff. And it was a lot of fun, a lot of good hanging out and stuff. So.
Great. Roger, John asks, why isn't the, I'm sorry, yeah, it was John. Why isn't the drummer included as an official member, which would actually make it a true quartet?
Well, as much as Jeremy Stacy, our drummer on this project, is near and dear to our hearts, and we love him like a brother, the songwriting and the whole focus, intention was always to do this as a trio. It wasn't until later Jeremy offered his drumming skills to us. And the name quartet, all these things happen at different stages. Quartet's just fun. We like the name. Obviously, we're not a quartet. But that's how that all unfolded.
Great. Eric, I don't see. Oh, yeah. Lowell asks, well, he first says, I love Sextus. I lived in Birmingham for several years, long after you left, but people you knew in places like Lou's Pub in the Garage. I'm curious, in your early years in the Ham, did you ever run into Will Owsley or interact musically with him in any way?
Well, that's actually a funny that he mentions that, because Will Owsley was a dear friend of mine, and not only was he a dear friend, I replaced him in the first band that I ever joined touring around the Southeast, and that would have been like 1988 or something. Anyway, he's still very missed by me to this day, and was the greatest guitar player that I've ever known, like, personally at all. So yeah.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Wait, was that band Love Bank?
No, that was a band called Baghdad.
Interesting.
It was an 80s rock band. We toured all over the Southeast and the college circuit, and I was like 18 years old, I think.
How many
the name
bandanas did you carry with you on that?
It was full on like that. Yeah. It was
well
like full on Club La Vila, kind of like Spring Break Madness, sort of,
I thought
fun.
maybe with the name Baghdad, I was going to assume that all your songs sounded like the hits that we know from the band Blamage, which all have that Middle Eastern new wave overtone to them.
Well, and a very talented group of guys, actually. The keyboard player was insane. We used to do what, Locomotive Breath, Jethro Tull, and he played the keyboard intro exactly. And he had hair like 3 feet high. He would take this really strong hairspray called Avec Instant and start combing his hair up, and it was like huge goth looking hair.
Good times.
Excellent.
Good stuff. So Glenn asks, we've only heard two tunes so far, but they both sound and feel modern yet timeless. 30 years from now, I expect they will still be fresh to listen to. What was your approach to songwriting and your determination as to what was a keeper and what wasn't good enough for to be a Licorice Quartet tune? And we'll kick that off with Roger.
Oh, well, I mean, one of the reasons the three of us can work together is we all have a fairly similar standard for our art and expectations for each other, from each other. And so there was fortunately no shortage of ideas floating around. But I think we all kind of, you know, we take tapes home and spend time with the songs. I think it became pretty clear which ones were rising to the surface for us as keepers for all three of us. That's really how it ended up. We had like, you know, 20 at some point.
Yeah. And
got reduced down to the 12 that have been recorded.
Tim, Eric, what was your approach to songwriting for this?
Well, it was, for me, it was just always about being as democratic as possible. Some of that was because I think even before we put our ears on tunes, you know, there was a little bit of history in the fact that the three of us never really had a chance to collaborate. And this was the first time we were going to be able to do that. So I think we all kept an open mind and an open heart to be driven by the other two with whatever we brought in and being willing to try whatever they wanted to try so that we could call this a true collaboration. Because I think we really had never had that experience as the three of us. So that was really important to me.
All right.
Yeah, pretty much what Tim said for me. I mean, same thing goes. The collaborative spirit of what we're, you know, having not been in a room writing together for several years was a wonderful experience.
Great. Here's a great question from Rob. He says, have Roger and Eric encountered people who recognize them from their cameo in the Brady Bunch movie, but not for all the great music?
No, it's always been by a fan who already knew of us from Imperial Drag or something like that.
Yeah.
Oh. That would be amazing. Hey, it's that guy that we see for 2 seconds in the Brady Bunch movie.
I've still never seen that. I guess I need to go see that. Were you on screen for any amount of time?
Yeah, it's 2 to 5 seconds and maybe more than once. And again,
that's
you have to...
money.
Yeah, exactly. Again, you have to know us from videos or being a fan to even do the face recognition.
What was that other movie that you played a rock guy in? Meet Us at the Greek or something like that? Weren't you in that too?
I was in the backup band, right? Russell Brand's backup band.
That's right.
For Get Into the Greek, thanks to mutual friend Lyle Workman.
Ah.
So he cast me and Victor and Drizzo and Sean Hurley. And then another gentleman named Lenny, whose last name I don't remember. But that turned into like 6 days of stand-in work.
Wow.
It was super surreal and tedious, but fun and just weird. And yeah, and the movie did okay.
Yeah.
Anthony asks, when doing vocal arrangements, is it generally Roger on the low to mid, Tim on the tricky middle ones like George Harrison, and Eric on the lead helium? Who wants to take that one?
Well, I mean, I'm happy to report that, again, the joy of working with this team of people is that we can kind of jump around. You kind of analyze what the goal is, and we know each other's voices really well, and you kind of figure, okay, you know, Eric should probably try this part first. Let's see how it goes. Or we'll do combinations. Sometimes there's three people unison for an effect, or Tim and I might take a part for an effect. And sometimes you even can just, you know, if we want like this powerful high chord up high, Eric may need to do that all by himself, you know, multi-track himself. So we're really lucky to have this vocal power to be able to do that. But you have to have the patience to experiment, because you go out there in front of the mic and you try stuff and you know, at least half the time, it's like, nope, that's not working. Whoa, you call yourself a singer? Oh my goodness. And then so you try different combinations until you get it.
Yeah, Anthony may have seen that video that you posted with Eric doing that kind of Roger Taylor super high part on Fadoodle. Chris has a great question here. He said, are there any Spinal Tap moments in your long, illustrious career so far, and any pre-show rituals that you can share?
What are you two?
Sheryl Crow used to say we were going to boil a squirrel before every show, but I never saw that happen. She talked about that a lot. There's so many sides of touring and playing that are just not glamorous, and the whole Hello Cleveland thing is about as true to form of going through. Gosh, I remember in the Jellyfish days, some of the things, places we'd walk through in our costumes and stuff, and just like the backs of kitchens and, seemingly in somebody's wardrobe closet coming out or something. It was just always kind of befuddled. You just always have to be willing and ready to take on ridiculous circumstances. And traveling and touring is all about that, and being able to adapt to whatever is in front of you. Some people do it better than others, but Spinal Tap is, I remember seeing that movie in the theater and people leaving going, that wasn't, I don't understand what I just saw, where I was in tears. So.
What do you think, Eric? Any Spinal Tap moments?
Literally my entire career. I mean, I swear, you watch that movie and parts you go, oh, that's definitely part of it. And then it'll happen to you like a month later on the road. So, Which Way to the Stage and This Much Talent, you know. And
Bloody Wanka. I
mean, Wanka. And now that guy that played the manager, I forgot the actor's name. The one that carried the cricket bat.
Yeah,
Liam. He sang a National Lampoon record called Genius's Pain, and he was doing a parody of John Lennon. Have you ever heard that before?
No, oh, wow.
It's absolutely hilarious. And Melissa Manchester played piano on it. But if you get a chance, check it out, because it's truly one of the funniest things I've ever heard.
Wow. Awesome.
I had one story about this where I was in a band, The Producers, a power pop band from the 80s. And at one time we were managed by an English fellow named Derek Sutton, who had managed Styx and lots of bands back. I think Jethro Tull was part of that at some point, but he insisted that he was the real person that they fashioned the whole manager thing about, because it's in the credits at the end, but he would tell us stories about how it's all real. All those things happened and he could prove it. So.
Awesome. Eric has a question for each of you. He asks, if you can have one and only one album that you've written, recorded, contributed to represent your legacy as an artist, which would it be?
Damn.
Tough question.
Well, it is, because each musical venture, you know, is kind of another side of your personality. And you're always doing your best and you're the one that has to, take the final product to the grave and look in the mirror. Every project I've been involved with has fulfilled a different part of my creative expression. So all the joys and things I'm proud of about like Spilt Milk, Imperial Drag, there's a whole different set because it was such a different band. So I'm just as proud of so much of that. And then there's Mood Cookbook. So I don't know. And TV Eyes was a whole different agenda. Pass.
All right.
I really don't know what to say. I don't value one of them. I'm proud of each of those foot forward, otherwise I wouldn't have released them.
Yeah, it's like choosing between your children.
Yeah, exactly. I was gonna say.
Yeah, You know, and the same goes for this Licorice Quartet thing. Obviously, I know what all 12 songs are about, as opposed to the people seeing this. And it's a whole other world that we've created that obviously there's overlap because we're just, you know, we're the same people making it that made music together 30 years ago. But we've really gone into some uncharted territory with great success.
Yeah.
So to be continued.
Yeah. Anything from you, Tim or Eric, or does that sum it up?
What he said.
What he said? Okay.
Right. Mo is their leader. You remember that Simpsons?
Yep.
I can't do all the talking.
Here's one. This is from Jared. He says, you're all fabulous singers. Who's taking the lead vocal in which parts on the two tracks so far? So for Lighthouse Spaceship and for Fadoodle, walk us through who's singing lead and who's singing the harmonies for those.
Eric, wants you to take that one?
Eric, you want to kick it off?
Well, yeah. I mean, like the verses have, for Lighthouse Spaceship, have like some splaying sort of chord things that happen arrangement wise. So that's pretty much all three of us, I remember, right? And so at least in the, yeah. Is that correct, guys?
Well, I think he's asking in terms of the lead vocal.
Oh, well, that's you and the. And the, yeah, Roger, you sing the lead vocal there, right? And then, gosh, it all blends together at a certain point.
Well, you have the ending of that song, kind of that, as it trails off. That's you, Eric, right? For Lighthouse.
Yeah, and at the end of the song, you do the bits, yeah, where before it goes into space and that kind of deal. So,
yeah.
You know, I look at a lot of what we do, too, is it's... As a lead vocalist, we're kind of, since we're all lead vocalists, we're really making a third instrument together when we sing, which is so wonderful to have that ability to do.
Well put.
So it all kind of blends and meshes together for me. So for me, yeah. Even for me, after knowing that we've been in the studio together singing all this stuff and knowing the arrangements, I still just sort of hear what we do as this kind of, well, that's the quartet part of the Licorice Quartet. If you want to put
there
it
you go.
Rather.
Well played, sir. Yeah, and there's a track off of the first EP that Tim sings. There's a magic number that you haven't heard yet. So everybody's doing lead vocal. Everybody's doing harmony vocal. Jim Walton has a really great question here. He said, was there a shared moment as the three of you were recording this new music when you all realized it was turning out as good or better than you expected?
I think we got the mixes back. We went, oh, that will do. I mean, again, for me, the whole process is pleasure and pain. It's really hard work, but I'm seduced and excited to keep moving forward. As early as our writing sessions, where I was excited by the raw song structures that I saw coming together. And I'm just like, that's solid as anything. If we can just get in the studio and flesh it out and connect the dots, we're going to be golden. And then that, of course, poses challenges and great rewards when you solve the puzzle. But, you know, every step of the way, you're like, okay, I think we got it. This stuff is sounding good. And you kind of just keep going down the checklist. Come mix time, it all comes together, including what last minute decoration and gluing things into more cohesion. And then, you know, even at that very last point, you still have the option of going, nope, not good enough. Leave it off the record. That happens all the time for artists.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very successful mega talents. We just kept going for it, making sure everything was living up to what it needed to be. So it wasn't until mix time, though, that, you know, hey, we've got it. And very, very proud of this. And
yeah,
here we go.
What about you, Tim? Was there a moment when you were in the studio, or was it later when you got the mix where you went, this is chemistry, this is working?
It was earlier than that for me. I think when we actually were when Jeremy came and we were had been working out the songs and we could actually sit there and play them, even if we didn't have lyrics, but we just had gibberish words, but you could hear the potential in the song. Then it was just a matter of figuring out which thing to plug in and do, you know, the plumbing part of it. But to be able to sit there and feel the potential of the songs when we were writing them was what got me excited, because, you know, you can go any number of a different ways in the studio, but if the bones aren't there to start from, it's just harder, in my opinion. So I was pretty excited from the get-go. I think that's why we've all kind of stuck through it, is we knew that, and, you know, gosh, it's been years since we started this, that knowing that we'd come back, and I forget sometimes because we had the 12 songs, we actually had more like 20 ideas, and when we finally culled them down to the 12, it was like you'd work on four for a time when we get together, and then I forget about some of them and go back, oh my God, we still got all these other ones. So it's been a pretty unending well of stuff to be excited about.
That's great. What do you think, Eric?
Yeah, I agree with Tim. Basically, I liked our live garage tape that we made in here when we were just, you know, writing the songs and just kind of doing it as a band, feeling it out together, you know. That's, then I had the, you know, ability to go back and listen to it and go, oh yeah, this could be really something exciting and special. So
great. So Nick asks, how did you come up with the experiences that you're offering on your website?
Well, I mean, we just gave it a lot of thought. I certainly was inspired by other artists and bands who had had fan engagement before. You know, we all share about what experiences worked well for both parties, which ones the people seem to be excited about. I had done some of my own for the Glamping Pledge campaign in 2018. I learned a lot from that. And so that's why, I mean, you know, hey, if you're reading this, please drop us a line for more suggestions, because there's no bad answers. We're learning what our fans find most rewarding and exciting to be a part of. And in general, for me, they've been a great experience. I look forward to getting better at them and kind of honing that part of the journey.
Awesome. Ned Hibbard writes, my 14-year-old son Teddy wants to know what inspired Lighthouse Spaceship. Eric, you want to take that one?
Yeah, sure. Lighthouse Spaceship was initially, I'm very much into words, like, you know, just keeping lists of words and images, you know, that conjure up some kind of imagination, hopefully, for someone. And I had that actually as a song title I'd been thinking about for a while, but then how to actually get it into something that was understandable didn't happen for, you know, a few years later. And then so that's kind of where it really started, from a list of song titles. And then, as you might be able to hear, it's a pretty upbeat, happy sort of ditty. And that was what I thought, you know, suited the title very well. And just kind of went with it from there. I thought it married well with the music.
Well, and let me interject, whether Eric knows it or not, having worked with him for as long as I have, he has this uncanny ability of really capturing the sentiment the music is providing. So when we were all working on Lighthouse and just creating music together, it made me feel a certain way, right? And you almost can't articulate it. And brilliant lyrics to me become an extension of that mood. And it can be subjective for everyone, but when Eric showed us the Lighthouse Spaceship lyrics, I was just, you know, pleasantly surprised yet again by how much it verbalizes these feelings and moods I was having as I saw this song taking shape in the studio. Because there was this fantastical, epic, otherworldliness to it. I wasn't necessarily thinking sci-fi or the imagery of the lighthouse shooting its light over the oceans, or the lights of, you know, almost like a Close Encounters of the Third Kind spaceship with all the lights. I wasn't necessarily thinking about all that, but when he shows the lyrics, it was like locked. It was like, there it is. Now we just, if anything, it inspired what we were going to do next musically. Certainly the intro. The intro was a chord progression that we're all like, good chord progression. But then we arranged it to be this, you know, total space odyssey. And that only made sense because of what the sentiment of the lyric was. They have to go hand in hand like that, ideally.
Yeah. Good. Cynthia asks, how are you guys experiencing the quarantine individually? Is that difficult for you? How are you getting through this whole situation? Tim, you want to kick that one off?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's not, this is not too dissimilar from the way my life is normally, which is in my studio and stuff. But, you know, I'm wearing a mask and I go to the grocery store a lot less than I was. And obviously, you know, I'm getting closer to my family because we're not watching sports or doing any of that stuff. And I've actually enjoyed that part of it. We're in a good position with my family and my wife and not having to worry about money like I know a lot of other folks are. And so we try and keep involved with our community and with the folks that we know are in working really hard to keep us all safe and find new things to help us through this time. It's I hope it's a moment for us to all find out what's really most important. And I'm trying to do that.
Eric, Roger, how are you guys getting through this quarantine?
It's ruined my nails.
Yeah, you're a twice a week nail guy.
Yeah. You need more vitamin D, go outside.
Okay.
Similarly to Tim, when I'm not touring with Beck, I'm freelancing in town, and an awful lot of that is from home. All kinds of assignments that I get to work on from home. Of course, that influx of work has changed, but it's still there, and I'm very thankful for that. And my girl, Laurel, she's in management, so she's can basically do most of her managing from home as well. She's still on the phone all day long. And what's funny is that at the beginning of this year, my therapist asked me, well, do you have any New Year's resolutions or things you really want to try to see happen? And one of them was, I need to figure out, because we both work so damn much, how to create more quality couples time. And weeks passed, and we both took off 1,000 miles an hour in the new year, and then the universe put the brakes on. So now we're getting plenty of couples time. No shortage.
Right.
I highly recommend finding your local drive-in for those listening, if your community has one, because it's a great way to get out of the house, have like a good old time with friends, and you guys just stay social distancing, watch a movie together. It's a great experience.
Great idea.
Discovered. So, and then just, you know, trying to continue to do things like give original music and artistic gifts to the world, because they really seem to be another form of medicine for people, of which, you know, we are all too happy to help with what I call a healthy distraction during these very challenging times.
Yeah. So Heath asks, you guys have all collaborated with some amazing artists over the years. Who is someone that you haven't collaborated with, but you'd like to in the future? Tim, you're smiling.
No, it's a lot of them are dead. So that takes a few off the thing.
Yeah.
You know, and it's weird because people that I would love to meet or whatever, I wouldn't necessarily want to collaborate with. Like, I would love to meet Andy Partridge from XTC. I'm a huge fan, but I just think I can't imagine how to collaborate with a guy like that. He's such a big presence. You know, maybe it would be fun, but my experience has been getting to meet heroes is the classic thing. Just have little expectation and let that experience take you where it wants to go. And so I wouldn't want to think less of of my heroes by trying to work with them.
What about you, Eric?
I think that's what Tim said, really. And I've been lucky enough to work with people I idolize, you know, like Alice Cooper. I mean, I've grown up on Alice Cooper records, of course. And it didn't disappoint me. The entire experience was wonderful. But I like to appreciate the purity of what another artist does, and I don't think that my tainting it would make it better necessarily, you know?
What about you, Roger? Anybody that you'd like to collaborate with?
You know, it's not so much collaborate as be in a room and watch how their head and heart operate.
Yeah.
So, I mean, a prime example, like Tim was saying, is Andy Partridge. But it'd be more about almost having a songwriting lesson with him. In other words, sure, let's try to create an original idea together. But I guarantee you how I assume he goes about it is going to be different than how he goes about it. And that's what's going to fascinate me. Elvis Costello is another person, Neil Finn, all the greats.
Sure.
I guarantee you they all go about it slightly different, and that's what fascinates me. I had the luxury of being on a Zoom conference where Elvis Costello was being interviewed. This was 3 weeks ago. It was invite only. I happened to know the host, who was a producer, and he produced Elvis and the Attraction's last album. So that's the only reason I was even invited on, because he knows what a huge fan I am. And I got to ask Elvis what it was like to collaborate with Burt Bacharach. And the biggest thing that Elvis shared is that, you know, all the assumptions that Elvis made about being a very prolific songwriter on his own for the last 40 years had nothing to do with how Burt Bacharach arrives at what he arrives at. So when they got together at first, it was actually a bit of a challenge until everybody understood how the other person approached it. And then once they figured out that, then it was kind of like, oh, you do it this way. Well, let me defer to you, kind of thing. And they eventually got some really great results. But I am fascinated by like the McCartney-Costello collaborations, because you literally can hear both their personalities like fused. The songs are incredible that they decided to release and share with the public.
Yeah.
And they're not entirely Elvis and they're not entirely Paul McCartney, but both of them are in there. So that fascinates me. And like Tim said, half of them have passed on. And some of them I've been able to meet and work with to some degree. Yeah, those are some names.
Yeah. Here's a great question from Scott. Do you all agree that D minor is the saddest of all keys?
Speaking of tap? Is that what
I don't even know if that deserves an answer. Rob wants to know what each of your go-to instrument is, meaning if you had to just pick up one instrument, if you wanted to, you know, write a song or get an idea, is it the instrument that you mainly play? Like for Roger, would you always just go right to the keyboards, or would you ever just pick up a guitar? And Tim, I wouldn't imagine you necessarily pick up the bass when you have an idea necessarily as your first instrument. What do you think?
Yeah, I would normally start with a guitar, although it's a challenge. I challenge any songwriter to actually pick up a bass and write a song with a bass, and let the melody be chosen by just that one low note instrument. If you can do that, whether it's Another One Bites the Dust or whatever.
Big Bottom.
Hello. Yeah. Then I think that's, yeah. That's a
God of Thunder. Gene Simmons.
Yeah.
Sorry, Tim.
No, that's okay. Fine.
Would the viewer like to witness a band squabble in real time?
Not in front of the kids.
I obviously go to keyboard. I don't have to think about it. But I have I'm not the guitar player I would like to be. I'm not the bass player I'd like to be. I've written a surprising amount of my favorite personal ideas on guitar because it's almost one hand tied behind your back. And so what actually ends up happening for me, and I learned this pretty early on, is a different part of my emotional body and thought process starts taking lead. And all I really need to do is pluck out the root notes on a guitar or basic bar chord that gets me through. It's in that kind of nakedness that your brain is forced to fill in more of the blanks. Certainly on keyboard, I'm more invited to kind of just be sedate and moody and jazzy and introspective and melancholy. There's no aggressive invitation like there is for drums. Anything you have to move this arm a la Pete Townsend to, that happens with guitar. So most of my rock stuff I've written standing up with the guitar on my body so I can go like this, because it dictates the rhythm and the energy. That's not going to happen at the piano. You have to really, I've always been fascinated by the song Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting by Elton John, because it's so guitar intensive. And Joe Jackson was another brilliant keyboardist who wrote some of the best guitar rock ever, in my opinion. Maybe Joe Jackson plays guitar well enough that he wrote a lot of those ideas on guitar. I don't know. But I've had to force myself away from the keyboard specifically for more highly energized music that I wanted to bring to the band. And by extension, some of my best ideas have come with no instrument in my hand, just walking around. Like in college, I would walk from class back to my dorm, and just the rhythm of walking and being a carefree college student with not a lot of responsibility, and just like, you know, literally skipping back to my dorm. I'd get these rhythmic patterns and I'd make up these melodies in my head. I go, that's an interesting melody. I wonder what the chord harmony is to it, because I'm not quite sure what that would be. And then I'd go back to the keyboard and fill in the blanks kind of thing. So I highly recommend it for any, get the hell away from your main instrument. You're going to come up with much more fascinating ideas.
Eric, do you ever get away from the Les Paul? Do you ever just start with keyboards or an acoustic or something else?
Well, I think that, you know, in the digital age, now that we've been in it for a long time, I usually do this, but there are times I want to get away from any semblance of what any instrument or genre or whatever would be associated, you know, I just want to get away from it. So I'll just start kind of note painting in my workstation, you know, mm-hmm. and just sort of like, well, composing bars of music and seeing where that goes first, you know, that's really rewarding to me, because eventually you'll find things that you can build on. So sometimes it doesn't even start with a melody. It might start with just raw composing, you know, not sounding good, not giving much of a care about that, just sort of free forming. And then sometimes I'll jam over that, and like all sorts of different things will pop up as well. Sometimes that can include a guitar, it could be a bass, or any stringed instrument, you know, and melodies sort of just kind of spring from that as well too. So it all kind of feeds off of each other.
Cool. Dizuko wants to know, have you ever met any fellow artists that you were surprised to learn that they were fans of yours and that most of us might not know about? I'm sure you guys meet people all the time where, you know, whether you're, you know, playing with them in the studio or live, where they'll come up to you and say, yeah, you know, I love your work. And it, I'm sure it's very flattering, but sometimes surprising, depending on the artist. Are there any artists that you can think of that that are fans of yours that might surprise people?
I was surprised. I live in Atlanta. I live in Decatur, actually. Just over the years of where I live, this is where the Indigo Girls are from, and they live around here, and I know them and stuff. And I had toured, done some shows with Sarah, with Sheryl Crow, where we played the Lilith Fair, and they were on the tour. And I had met them back in the day or whatever, but they didn't know much about, or at least I didn't know, but they were huge jellyfish fans. I couldn't believe it. They knew all about it. And every time I see Emily around in restaurants and stuff, she's like, what's this thing you're doing with Roger and Eric? You know, musically, it's such a different world, but she surprised me and how much she likes a vast array of things. And I think that's something that most folks that I've run into that like what we've done or what we've been a part of have a pretty wide palette of things that they're interested by. So that was a surprise for me.
Roger, Eric?
I've certainly played on some people's records in the past that I'm not remembering their names right now. That part of why I got called in is because they knew Imperial Drag or Jellyfish stuff. Actually, guys in Air reached out to me and my partner Brian Kehoe because of the Mood Cookbook stuff we'd done, mm-hmm. which was, I was a fan of Air before they reached out to us at all. I was already in love with what they were doing and really pleasantly surprised by it. So I was a fan for sure. So that was very flattering and surprising that they knew any of that material. But it's usually just, you know, it's a real joy to be leaving a Beck show and somebody flags me down. I'm like, oh, hey, thank you. Yeah. No. We want you to autograph these records of yours,
yeah,
not a Beck album,
yeah.
And then we came to the show to see you and Jason play, and there was a couple in where was it? It was New Orleans, I think, that were obsessed with Imperial Drag, and they brought all their Imperial Drag vinyl and CDs and collectibles nice. For me to sign, and all the guys in the Beck band were like, what is all this stuff? That was another life. I'll tell you about it later. But that's always great.
Yeah. What about you, Eric?
Well, I did. I met Mark McGrath from Sugar Ray about, I don't know, last year sometime. And I was surprised to learn from him that he's a massive Jellyfish fan. And that was just something I should have maybe put that together because, you know, Sugar Ray is obviously sort of a 90s pop, hip hop sort of thing. But yeah, we hit it off pretty well. He's a nice guy.
Cool. We just go ahead.
Sorry, I got to interject because Eric just reminded me of the kind of punk community of which Sugar Ray originally came from. I got to meet one of my heroes, two of my heroes, Steve and Bill Stevenson from Descendants / Black Flag, and through my girl Laurel. And Bill Stevenson thought that Laurel was joking that she was going out with the guy from Jellyfish because he was such a fan of those records, as was Steve and his bandmate. And he didn't believe it at first. He wasn't put, because so much time has passed since he's seen my picture or in a video or whatever. This is like 30 years later. He goes, no, you're that Roger Manning. You're that. And I'm thinking, I'm talking to Bill Stevenson, because I was like, him and his bandmates just, so many game changers over the years. And for him to say anything flattering at all about even one song was just like, it was super weird because those people were so inspirational to me at a very important age in my trajectory.
Yeah.
And having, you know, they are the reason there's any power at all in my so-called power pop contributions. It's just like, you got to rock this shit. And those people really taught me what that was about, you know, at that time. Anyway.
Yeah, that's good. Just a couple more questions, guys. One from Steve. He wants to know from each of you, which now defunct band did you never get to see live but wish that you could have?
We don't have enough time.
I'd probably start with XTC. I never got to see them. And a lot of people didn't get to see them, but when I joined the producers, they had seen them in 1980 or something, because they had been on the same, they were booked by the same FBI, which was one of the Copeland brothers booking agency or whatever. And They were just such an influential band to me. I wish I would have seen them.
Cool. Eric?
You know, I probably wish a lot of people, but maybe like Jeff Buckley or something. You know, I would have liked to see him, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. I never got to see Prince. And there were opportunities. It just, I didn't make it happen in time.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. One final question for the three of you. What's next for the Licorice Quartet? What do you guys have coming? I know you've got the EP. What's coming after that?
More EPs? Yeah, we have our work cut out for us, just getting these next two in the queue.
Yeah, you mentioned you have 12 songs that you've worked on so far. So you've got four for Threesome Volume 1. Can you give us a little sneak peek at what's coming next, like on the next EP? Any tracks you want to talk about? Or?
Well, I think it's really worthwhile to say that, and I'm very happy to be able to share this. If you think you've got the Licorice Quartet figured out based on this first EP, you're going to be pleasantly surprised. I mean, we happily venture into some very different territory while maintaining all those things that people seem to know and love about us. And I'm really excited to share those other sides of our personality on these future EPs.
Fantastic. Any other final closing remarks, gentlemen?
I think it'll be interesting for folks to hear Eric singing more. He'll be singing lead on a lot more coming up. And like Roger said, it's just stylistically pretty vast. And in the future, I mean, we're going to probably all do a little bit of our own solo stuff and re-releasing of that stuff in the coming months as well. So just trying to find ways to connect with fans, like, through these types of things, because we're not really planning on touring, nor could we right now, but we're just open to trying to be as connected and positive in what we're doing musically to get our music out there. So we're excited about it. It's been fun to do these kinds of things. And we've been collaborating on some cover songs that we're going to try and put together soon for folks to watch us play, and this sort of Zoom setup, and working through all those at the moment. So that'll be fun to look out for too.
Awesome. Good.
Well, and a big collective thank you. I mean, again, this is the reason we're even able to have these fantasies about sharing this stuff, is that we know that there's this fan base that's ever expanding, that's just been with all of us independently and together for so long.
Yeah.
Which is, that in and of itself is a miracle to me, and I don't take it for granted. None of us do, and I'm just, eternally grateful, particularly at a time like this. It's like, ooh, there's some gray clouds outside. Yeah, but the fans want to hear some more music. Okay, great, let's do it.
Yeah.